Locked On Rams, Locked On Seahawks listeners, welcome back to another episode of both podcasts here. Thank you guys so much for always joining us and for always making us your first daily listen every single day. Of course, you guys know what we do on the Locked On Podcast Network here on Thursdays. It is a crossover episode. I'm Sosa Kremenjas, your host of the Locked On Rams podcast, joined by my good friend for the second time this season, Corbin Smith, host of the Locked On Seahawks podcast. And Corbin, it's a little bit of a strange situation how we're headed into this week 15 schedule here. The Rams have some weird storylines going on, a lot of, you know, kind of evolving roster situations here, transactional moves. A lot of players that we don't know if they're going to suit up for this game or not. The Seahawks probably on a much better schedule here in terms of at least who they're probably going to have available for this game. So you look at the Seahawks team, they're sitting at 5-8. They are not mathematically eliminated just yet. And of course, quarterback Russell Wilson back in the fold here. I don't think you can ever count out a team that has Russell Wilson. Like, this guy can play some football. He's always into it. And then the Rams, of course, sitting in second place here in the NFC West. 9-4, fifth seed in the NFC playoff picture. I'm going to ask you, Corbin, here and kick it over to you. How did the Seahawks get here? What's kind of the storyline going into this game with the Seahawks? How are they feeling trying to gear up for a potential playoff run?
I'll tell you what, if you would have had this show 2 weeks ago, I've been like, look, let's just get this season over with. But this team has been confident all year long that they were going to find at some point they were going to get a win streak rolling, and they were going to find a way to claw back into this. And they really have had some really rough circumstances. I mean, losing Russell Wilson for three games, and honestly, the three games after he came back from surgery, he was not ready to play. There's no question in my mind. I think Geno Smith probably should have played at least one or two more games. He was not right. He might have been healthy enough to play, but he was not right. The last 2 weeks, we have seen vintage number three come out, though. We had a really good game against the 49ers. 30 for 37, should have had three passing touchdowns. Gerald Everett dropped one of them, and it turned into an interception. But he was near flawless in that game. And then the Texans, a far inferior opponent, but Russell Wilson had a great game against them on Sunday. So he looks like the player we are used to seeing with Russell Wilson. They've got Tyler Lockett rolling. They're still trying to get DK Metcalf playing to what he's capable of doing. And maybe the biggest thing, they finally got a run game going last week. Rashad Penny, an incredibly talented player that just has not been able to stay healthy. They get 137 rushing yards and two long touchdowns out of him. And so they're really excited to have Rashad Penny in the backfield against the Rams defense that he actually has had some success against in the past. And this might be a little bit of a revenge game for him because he tore his ACL in Los Angeles 2 years ago. And that's really what started a downward spiral for his career and really got him off track. He's now back on that track playing like he's capable of. So they're hoping having him back there with Russell Wilson playing the way that he is right now, that this is going to be a far more difficult offense for the Rams to stop going into this rematch.
Yeah, I think, you know, it's good to see someone like that get back into the fold. You talk about, you know, he's a former first-round pick. This guy's got a lot of talent. And ironically enough, you know, I'm a fantasy football player. I write about fantasy football. Everyone's kind of had their eyes on him as the, you know, golden addition this week, we'll call it, in the waiver wire. Clearly a guy that looks to be separating himself as the RB1 there. Now, you talk about the Rams here. I mean, I could spend 45 minutes speaking on this team right now. There are so many weird moving parts. Of course, the Rams have 16 players in the COVID protocol right now. They've actually shut down their facility for 2 days. Everybody working from home. A lot of moving parts. We do not know who's going to be available for this upcoming matchup. I've talked about it on my podcast pretty much all week. A lot of star power that's on this list right now. You're talking about guys like Jalen Ramsey, Odell Beckham Jr. Every day they're adding new players, Jordan Fuller. And of course, today, three more added to that list. Outside linebacker Justin Hollins, tight end Johnny Munt, who tore his ACL about 2 months ago. So unfortunate for him that he still got tattoo. And then tight end Jared Pinkney as well, which kind of seems like the theme here, right? Kind of infiltrates one of these positional groups. And of course, these guys are always together all day, every day, sitting next to each other, practicing all these kind of things. And then it kind of spreads. So you see a lot of the same kind of positional groups being doubled down here. And it's unfortunate because, I mean, the Rams right now, like I mentioned, sitting at 9-4, they come off a season-defining win, really, in my opinion, on Monday Night Football against a divisional foe for both teams here in the Arizona Cardinals on the road, down five or six starters due to COVID and some injury situations there. And they feel like they're starting to claw back into this potential race for the NFC West title. And that's what the Rams want to do. I mean, you want to finish in that 1-4 seed to get a home playoff game. But now, still a game back. We'll call it a game and a half, really, because the divisional wins kind of shake out for the Cardinals here. And the Rams still got to catch up, really, not just in terms of record, but divisional record, conference wins, all these kind of things, tiebreakers. So going into this game, the Rams are in a weird, sticky situation. We're going to see ultimately how they come out of it. You know, on Friday, even Saturday, you were mentioning to me, Corbin, they kind of had this weird rule implemented after, you know, Gerald Everett situation there with COVID. So I don't know who's going to be available for the Rams here. I don't know how much firepower they're going to have available, but it's concerning for the Rams because this team, you know, they did beat the Seahawks earlier this season, and that was the game that Russell Wilson got hurt in. But there's been a lot of battles between these two teams, always pretty close, in my opinion. And feels like, you know, anytime divisional teams play each other, you really don't know what to expect. I mean, a lot of people expected the Cardinals to win this game against the Rams, and somehow always weird kind of things happen in between these two teams. So the Rams right now sitting pretty. I mean, 9-4, I think they like where they're at. The offense is starting to click again. They've implemented a lot of different kinds of strategies, going to 12 personnel, 13 personnel, six offensive linemen out there, not so much empty and gun like they were in that rough patch there in November. Defense looks like they're starting to click as well. I think Raheem Morris getting a lot more comfortable with his unit there. Aaron Donald, I mean, I just posted something on Twitter about it. I think he had more pressures, or as many as like 12 or 14 teams this past week, which is just absurd. One player equaling 14 teams. I mean, that's just crazy. The guy can literally take over a game. And I think, you know, Russell Wilson and those guys can attest to that at certain times. So when you talk about this defense, Corbin, you kind of mentioned it. The Seahawks playing a little bit better on that side of the ball. How's that side of the ball look for them?
Well, I had a few people on social media that were laughing at me a couple weeks ago because I said they've been borderline elite, but you look at the numbers and they have, and maybe the most misleading thing, they are 32nd in the NFL in yards allowed, but a big problem has been the offense has been so bad most of the season, and they've been losing the time of possession battle by like 20 minutes a game, that the defense has been out there for a bazillion plays. That's why Bobby Wagner's on pace for like 600 tackles this year. Not just because he's great, but because they're on the field constantly. So that's been a big part of it. I mean, they're fifth in scoring defense in the NFL. They're in the top five since week six. Their secondary play has been much better. They've been really good stopping teams on third down. They're in the upper third in the league in three and outs created. So even though they've had a lot of possessions that have been long ones, they've also created a lot of three and outs. Really, the one thing that just hasn't come together for this group, everything else has. Their run defense has been outstanding. The corners are playing well. Good safety play, even without Jamal Adams now done for the season. The pass rush has been the one missing ingredient, at least in terms of consistency. If they could find just a little more of a pass rush, this is a top five defense in the NFL. The way they've played really for most of this season, really the turning point was that first game against the Rams where they played so bad in the second half. They have really come together since that game. And as a unit, they've had a few hiccups in there, but they've been really good. And the only things have been missing are the pass rush and the lack of turnovers. And even without Robert Woods, I know they're looking at this as a game that's going to be a huge challenge because they're facing the most talented offense they have faced in that entire stretch. So this will be a good litmus test for them to see where they're truly at as a defense.
Yeah, and we have yet to find out who's going to be available for the Rams on that side of the ball. Like you mentioned, no Robert Woods, of course. Tyler Higbee sounds like he should be back. Darryl Henderson, is he going to be back? The right tackle, Rob Havenstein, center, Brian Allen, wide receiver, Odell Beckham. They're ravaged. They're ravaged right now. This might be an offense coming in at, you know, half strength, if not even less than that. But in just a second here, we're going to dive into some of these matchups to watch, and we're going to get into some of these specifics here, as well as the keys to victory, maybe a little bit of a score prediction at the end there as well. You guys, nobody plays daily fantasy sports to lose. I mean, let's call it what it is. Winning feels way better, but traditional fantasy sports are a long-term losing proposition because you never know who you're going up against or what you're going up against. Stat Hero is the first of its kind in the daily fantasy sports platform where it's you versus the house in head-to-head fantasy matchups with the winner taking all. And here's the crazy part. Stat Hero shows you their lineups before you play, and you can handpick the team that you want to face one-on-one. Why? Because you don't have to compete against thousands of experts or unknown lineups that they're not going to show you. Stat Hero puts you in control of your own fate. With Stat Hero, you're in control of the stakes. You can decide how much you're going to play for And Stadio has no choice but to take it because they are daring you to beat them. The head-to-head matchup this week, Matthew Stafford, Tom Brady, Jimmy Garoppolo. Interesting battle here. Maybe you don't want to lean with Matthew Stafford if what Corbin is saying ends up being true in this one. It's going to be tough, obviously, with a good team across from him. You look at Tom Brady and the Buccaneers. I believe they're playing the Saints this week, which really tough matchup there. They're one of the better secondaries in football. And Jimmy Garoppolo, probably the least talented guy of that trio. So maybe you don't want to go with Jimmy, but that's the fun in it. You got to decide really who is going to be the highest scoring player out of those three. If you guys want to go check it out, sign up for free right now at stathero.com/lockedon and use promo code locked on for a 100% deposit match. That's stathero.com/lockedon. Use the promo code locked on for a 100% match. stathero.com/lockedon with the promo code locked on. Terms and conditions apply.
All right, Sosa, let's get to the matchups going into this Week 15 rematch. And my co-host Rob Rang and I were joking about this on yesterday's show. Normally, we do a very extensive matchup-based episode, but we had to put an asterisk next to it because we don't know what players are going to be playing for the Rams on Sunday. It feels like half their roster is on the COVID-19 reserve list heading into this game. Just everything up in the air on both sides of the ball, even on special teams. I mean, you name it, the Rams right now have a lot of uncertainty they're dealing with. But looking at this game in Week 15, assuming that the vast majority, if not all those players on that list, are available to play on Sunday, when you look at the Seahawks defense, I mentioned they're playing a lot better as of late. What is a matchup that concerns you for the Rams on offense heading into this rematch?
Yeah, so I think one area where the Rams certainly are going to have to look out for, and it feels easy to say, and I'm not going to go with it, that's why, but I was going to say Bobby Wagner. He's always a guy you have circled there. That guy is just special, but I'm actually going to go to the back end there and go with Matthew Stafford's former teammate there in Quandre Diggs. This is a guy that I know you've mentioned it. You've kind of put me on him as well. One of the more underrated players in the NFL. Like, this guy doesn't really get his due, and I think he's really played, I mean, not just this year. I mean, over the past few years even, at a Pro Bowl level. Like, this guy really has a lot of talent. And if I don't actually recall properly, he might have picked off Matthew Stafford in that first game on a very...
Oh, he did.
Yeah, the errant pass in the end zone there. The Rams are driving. I think they're probably around the 10-yard line, something like that. And I think Stafford tried to throw the ball away, but obviously just wasn't a good pass in any regard, and gives Diggs a chance to go grab it, and it was a fantastic catch. So, ironically enough, I just thought of that as I was speaking. Great player. I think this guy has a lot of skills. He's got a lot of talent. You can use him, you know, as a single high guy. You can put him in the box. Clearly got ball skills as well. And he knows Matthew Stafford. These guys are probably pretty good friends. They spent time together in Detroit, of course. So I'm going to circle Quandre Diggs as one of the guys that I think the Rams have to look out for on this side of the ball. And I mean, I haven't watched, you know, with a keen eye over the past few weeks, but Jamal Adams, I guess he's done for the season. That probably puts even more pressure on a guy like Quandre Diggs to really take his game to another level, having to kind of, you know, set up for two spots now. Losing a player of Jamal Adams' caliber, it's never good. But, Corbin, I'm going to kick it over to you. You look at this Seahawks offense, and maybe it's easy to say after this week. I think we're all kind of looking at number 99 to see if he can have some sort of an encore type of performance here. But is there any kind of matchup that you're looking at circled? And again, some players might not play, some might play for the Seahawks offense going against the Rams defense.
You know, I would typically just go with the easy cop-out because we all know that Aaron Donald is the most concerning player on that defense for any opponent. And Russell Wilson, I've joked about this time and time again, aside from Sierra, nobody has been closer to him than Aaron Donald. I mean, he just lives in the backfield. So I could use that as the cop-out, but I also got to go with the guy that's been Russell Wilson's kryptonite. And now that Darious Williams is back and had a big game on Monday night, three pass breakups, Russell Wilson probably still has nightmares about that pick six from the playoffs last year. It feels like he's got 80 interceptions when he's played against Russell Wilson, and him against Tyler Lockett. And if Jalen Ramsey's available, him and DK Metcalf, that's get your popcorn ready TV. But Darious Williams against Tyler Lockett, considering how well Tyler Lockett has been playing as of late, even by his standards, averaged almost 30 yards per reception against the Texans last week. And he put all of his skills on display. I want to see those two going at it. Darious Williams, one of the most underrated corners in football, a smaller guy, athletic, plays with physicality, going against Tyler Lockett, an incredible route runner, a player that can win over the top, can also beat you in the short to intermediate game. tons of toe drag swag. I mean, he's got the entire bag of tricks. I just think that those two matchups on the outside, I'm especially excited about Lockett going up against Williams. There's some concern there because Williams is such a good player and he's had Russell Wilson's number, but you want the best going against the best. And those are two matchups that both are concerning, and yet at the same time, as a football fan, you want to see those two matchups going against each other. Now let's flip the switch here. Looking at that Seahawks offense, what worries you the most? What's the most concerning matchup for the Rams defensively having to deal with? The Seahawks offense that seems like it's found some traction the last couple games.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. I was going to go with Tyler Lockett as well. I mean, I'll say the passing game kind of extended into the whole unit there. I feel like they're really starting to click right now, right? They're really getting comfortable. You watch Tyler Lockett. I mean, this guy has just been absolutely outstanding. DK Metcalf, I mean, not been fully integrated, I feel like, since Russell's kind of come back. But if I'm not mistaken, he had a catch in the end zone that was nearly a touchdown just a week ago or so. Yeah. And I mean, this guy's got all the talent in the world. The talent is not the issue. The performance is not the issue. Just kind of got to find a way to get him the ball a little bit more, which, you know, I think every star receiver kind of feels that way. They want the football more. So you look at this cornerback room right now for the Rams, and that's the concern for me here. Talk about Darious Williams, solid player, maybe not had as good of a season as he had last year. He still doesn't have a single interception on the season. So Russell Wilson may be able to breathe a little bit, you know, light on this one, but you never know going into this game. The other spot is kind of where I'm circling and thinking about, you know, is there some concern here? Because yes, if Jalen Ramsey's out there, you feel great. This guy is, you know, the best cornerback in football, but he might not be good to go. And if that's the case, then the Rams had to call a guy up from the practice squad last week, and he was starting the day of his call-up. I mean, he had no idea he was going to be starting. The Rams lost Dante Dion, their third corner, to COVID. They lost Jalen Ramsey the day of the game to COVID as well. And Kareem Moore was a guy who stepped in there, as well as David Long Jr. Long been a little bit up and down this season, played a pretty solid game on Monday Night Football, but there's a reason this guy was benched after four games to start the season. And then you look at Kareem Moore. This guy has pretty much no NFL experience. He was certainly picked on Monday Night Football. Smart of Kyler Murray to do that. Take your matchups and beat the guys that have no NFL experience. So if Jalen Ramsey's not out there, if Dante Dion's not out there, I think there's a lot of concerns here. I really think that, you know, there was a couple of passes last week against the Cardinals that were fairly open. I mean, potential touchdowns that Kyler just couldn't hit, or, you know, he was getting pressured, got sacked, whatever the case is. So I don't know how these guys can hold up. I don't know if Ramsey's going to be back. If he's back, then, you know, we're kind of all eating our popcorn for this one, looking at two, you know, superstar receivers against two superstar corners. If not, then I certainly think the Seahawks are going to have a nice advantage there. But that takes us to the Seahawks defense here against this Rams offense. What do you kind of got circled here?
Well, this is one of those, kind of like you just hinted at, I got to see who's actually on the field. But assuming that Odell Beckham Jr. is going to be out there, I've still got to say Cooper Kupp is the player that concerns me the most, because, my goodness, he's on pace for like 250 catches this year. And they use him in so many different ways. And I love watching Cooper Kupp play because he is a true football player. You can put him all over the formation. He does the dirty work. That's what the Seahawks players were all saying today. That was the first thing out of their mouth when you asked about Cooper Kupp. He does the dirty work. He can block. He can run routes from the slot. You can run the ball with him. You can throw it to him on the outside. He is one of the best receivers in football because he can do so many things so well. And he has killed the Seahawks over the years. Robert Woods would have been probably my first pick here because he's been an even bigger Seahawks killer. But without him being there, Cooper Kupp going against Seattle's secondary, while it's been a lot better the last couple of months, this is going to be a major test for them against a guy that's just gotten first down after first down after first down against this defense over the years. Going to be a major problem. And even with the secondary playing the way that it has, there's no question in my mind that that's the number one, number two, and number three priority to stop for the Seahawks, because he has been a guy that's been an absolute game wrecker against them with his reliability, his soft hands, the ability to win short, intermediate, even downfield some. He's just caused major problems for them. So this is a true challenge. I mentioned earlier, it's a litmus test for this defense, most specifically cornerback Sidney Jones and DJ Reed. You guys have played really well, like a top five cornerback group the last four or five games, but you haven't faced a Cooper Kupp. Can you take this challenge and show, hey, we are a legit top five cornerback group? This is a great opportunity for them to do that. That's also a great chance for Cooper Kupp to go off again and say, You guys aren't there yet. And so that's kind of the concern here for the Seahawks defense. We're going to get to our keys to victory and predictions here coming up in a moment. But I got to tell you about these Stance socks, Sosa. They are fantastic. Comfortable, sleek-looking socks to change up your footwear game. Stance has got you covered. Founded in 2009, Stance Apparel represents a radical reinvention of socks, underwear, and active apparel. They've got a sharp focus on comfort, quality, and creativity. Stance brings you an atypical aesthetic alongside some of pop culture's hottest collaborators for the ultimate in style and self-expression. I'm a superhero nerd by heart, so I've got a bunch of different pairs of Stance socks, and I got Batman ones, Star Wars ones, super comfortable, and no wear and tear on them after wearing them a bunch of times. Fantastic product, which is really big for me because I've got huge feet. Size 14 feet for a 6 foot tall guy. Not necessarily easy to find good socks, but Stance has been perfect. Stance believes that the perfect fit matters more than fitting in, that those that feel good do good. Go see for yourself. Register for an account at stance.com and get 15% off your first purchase. Use the promo code LOCKEDON at checkout to apply and enjoy the color and comfort of a life less ordinary with Stance.
And you guys know, if you've listened to this podcast, Locked On Rams specifically, we like to get into the betting game, man. It's fun. It kind of spices up this matchup. Nearly hit another parlay last week, and one Sony Michel touchdown away from hitting it. Would have been two in a row. Very, very close. Unfortunately, I couldn't get it. But if you guys want to get in on some of that action, go check out betonline.ag. They have you covered all season with more odds, props, and lines than ever before as football season continues its march towards the playoffs. BetOnline remains your number one spot for all your sports action this season. So go ahead to their new website or updated desktop website to sign up today and receive your welcome bonus, which is 50% on your first deposit. Just use our promo code LOCKEDON to receive your bonus from football to basketball, NHL, boxing, UFC, right to your favorite Vegas casino games. Don't wait and make sure to take advantage of all the amazing offers available right now for the 2021 season. BetOnline is the safest and easiest way to bet on all your favorite sports. BetOnline, where the game starts. Now, thank you guys so much for always making Locked On Rams, Locked On Seahawks your first daily listen. For your second daily listen, go check out Locked On Bets. They're going to help you out with some of those bets at betonline.ag. They're your daily one-stop shop for all your gambling needs. Locked On Bets, hosted by your boy Q, with expert analysis and insight from Lee Sterling. Now we're going to pick up here, Corbin, with this final segment, the keys to victory for both teams here. Some of these score predictions. I don't know about you. Everyone loves the score predictions where I'm at, on YouTube especially. They all want to know what's the score, who's going to win. I don't have a crystal ball, but I do think that we could both shoot over some predictions and we'll see ultimately how it goes. Before we get into that, I'll kick it to you first. You look at some of these keys to victory for the Seahawks. What do you have circled here?
Well, it's pretty obvious on offense. I think Russell Wilson has got to be able to get the football out of his hands in a timely manner. One of the things that I think really hurt them in the first matchup this year and the playoff loss to the Rams last January is they weren't able to get that short passing game, particularly to their tight ends going. Not having Gerald Everett against his former team in week five was a big deal. But they're going to have Gerald Everett in this game, and he's going to be excited for the chance to play against his former team. They got their tight ends going a little bit last week. Everett had a touchdown catch. Will Disley had a few receptions. With that pass rush that the Rams have, particularly Aaron Donald, his ability to be a disruptor all game long, yes, you want to get some of your downfield shots, and I think they can get a few of those, but you're going to have to be able to move the ball through methodical drives, getting that short passing game going, and that means getting your tight ends involved against linebackers. I like those matchups for the Seahawks. I think they've got the guys at tight end. You've just got to use them and maybe even get a few dump offs to Rashad Penny and Alex Collins in the run game and just some quick dump offs so that you can keep yourself on schedule. They've had too many times they haven't been able to do that because Russell Wilson's held on the ball too long. And next thing you know, Aaron Donald is eating him in the backfield. So got to get the football out quickly. As far as the defensive side of the ball, to me, the biggest thing is limiting the explosives. That was what really killed them in that first matchup. Matthew Stafford's going to make some of his plays in the passing game. They've got their weapons on the outside. But if you can limit those 20-plus yard pass plays, there were way too many of them the second half of that game. They've done a really good job the last six or seven games of taking those explosives away. If you can do that in this game and force the Rams to live and die with the shorter passing game and force them to run the ball. I think that that really does play into Seattle's hands here and maybe takes the ball out of Matthew Stafford's court a little bit. So those would be the two big keys for me on both sides of the ball. Seattle can do those two things. I like their chance, especially if the Rams are shorthanded this weekend.
Yeah, and for me, I think I'm kind of playing into your hand here. I think the Rams on the offensive side of the ball, when I kind of look at, you know, some of the personnel they'll have here and sort of the balance that they've had over the past few weeks, for me, it's going to be to run the football, and I guess that kind of strays into staying ahead of the chains, just making sure, you know, Sony Michel, they've kind of rotated from Darrell Henderson early season as the first running back, the bell cow, to now Sony Michel as the bell cow, and we don't know if Henderson's going to play in this game. He's been nursing a thigh injury, also on the COVID list. Surprise, surprise. Now they've had, you know, Sony Michel is the lead back the last 2 weeks. He has more rushing attempts than any single running back in the NFL, I think 44 to be exact, over the last 2 weeks. And this is a guy that doesn't have breakaway speed. He's not going to go, you know, for 25, 50, 75 yards. He's not going to break that long one, but really, really good at churning his legs, creating yardage after contact, staying ahead of the chains, turning 3 yard gains into 5 or 6 yard gains. That's what he does well. And I think that switch to him was a symbol of how this offense really started to get back on track. They went under center, not so much five wide and gun and empty and shotgun and all that stuff. Back under center, a lot of play action, a lot of handing the football off, as I mentioned, more rushing attempts than anybody else, and going 12 personnel, 13 personnel, 6-plus offensive linemen. I think this balance has been very good for their offense, been very good for their passing game as well. You start to see some of those longer developing play action passes start to work. Van Jefferson scoring a 52-yard touchdown last week against the Cardinals. I really think that's where they're at their best, where they can kind of mix and match a little bit of everything, make defensive coordinators prepare for a myriad of things, not just, you know, we're going to go five wide 45 times this game and kind of get stale. I think that's where they really started to fall off in November. So that's the first thing on the offensive side of the ball. Switching to the defense here, it's going to be getting off the field on third downs. They've done a really good job, I think, at getting teams into third and seven, third and nine, third and 11 type of situations, long down and distances, but they've struggled most of the season at getting off the field. This past week, a little bit better, but there was still a handful of instances that felt like back-breaking situations, right? It's third and 13, third and 16, and Kyler Murray's a special kind of player. I understand it. Russell Wilson, exact same type of mold. Those guys want to get out of the pocket, and that's where they do their most damage, but you got to get off the field on third and 15. There is just no way you can let them convert. They do a really good job at forcing teams, you know, to gain 1 or 2 yards in the run department. They're really, really good as a defensive line there. And then they want to tee off on third and seven, third and nine type situations. But these corners, I just don't know if they can hold up, how they're going to hold up. And that is why this defensive line needs to win consistently like they did last week. That's going to give potentially some of these backup corners their best shot to actually try and, you know, hold up in coverage. I don't know that you can expect a guy like Kareem Orr or somebody else like David Long to lock down two of the game's best receivers. So it's going to be win up front on the defensive line, get off the field on third downs, get that ball back into your offense's hands. And I guess that's going to do it for these keys to victory. I'm going to kick it back to you now, Corbin. Do you have any kind of prediction for this game, any score prediction, or just in general, what you think, you know, you might be looking out for here?
Well, Seahawks fans, you know, they're probably going to be mad initially when I make this prediction. But if you're looking at my track record this year, I've only gotten 3 games right the entire season. Last year, I was 12-4 at the end of the year. Actually, 13-3. It was 13-3. So I had a great year. This year, I've been like the Seahawks. I've completely fallen off with my predictions. So I think the Rams, I'm assuming that they're going to have a lot of their key players that are on the COVID list available for this game. The Seahawks have a lot of momentum going into this game, but I just, on the road, with some of the issues they've still got protecting against good pass rushes, I can't see the Seahawks pulling off this upset, given the way things have played out this year. I think it's going to be close. I think the Seahawks are a quality football team. They're better than their record indicates, but I don't think they are as good as the Rams when the Rams are close to full strength. So I'm going to go 27-23. Rams. I think it's a close game. I think Russell Wilson and Matthew Stafford have a chess match, but I think the Rams find a way to get in the end zone one more time than the Seahawks do, and that ends up being the difference in this contest. I think that the Seahawks will have some success on defense, but this is a different animal they're playing against with the receivers that the Rams have. They ran the ball a little bit better as of late. Not having Jamal Adams is going to be something I think is significant because his pass rushing ability in this game I think would have been valuable. You don't have that asset now with him being done for the season. So, you know, I think the Seahawks, they've made a valiant run, but I think this is the nail in their playoff coffin. And I think the Rams are the ones that are going to drive it into the coffin.
Yeah, I tend to agree. I think the Rams are just a little bit more talented right now. It feels like they're kind of clicking as well. Of course, you know, anything could change, I guess, over the next few days. There could be more COVID cases. There could be guys coming back. I'm going to assume some of these guys come back and the Rams are halfway to full strength, at least kind of like they were against the Cardinals. And in that scenario, at home, you got a lot of momentum. You're coming off back-to-back wins. You're sitting at 9-4. You got a lot to play for right now. I feel like the Rams are going to be just as desperate as the Seahawks, which might sound kind of funny for a team that's fighting for their literal playoff life. But I think the Rams are going to be able to come out of this one with a victory. I'm going to say, you know, 31-27. I do think it'll be a one-score game. I do think it'll be fairly close. And I do foresee both offenses having a lot of success in this game. But I do think the Rams are just a little bit more talented right now. I trust that coaching staff. I trust some of those, you know, high-end rostered players, guys like Aaron Donald, to step up and shoulder some of that weight if guys like Jalen Ramsey can't play in this game. So ultimately, we're going to have a lot of fun in this game. I think it's going to be a good matchup between two teams that are both desperate for victories right now for different kind of reasons, but it is going to be a good game. So Locked On Rams, Locked On Seahawks listeners, thank you guys so much for always tuning back in here for another episode. Make sure to tune back in tomorrow to both podcasts. Get your last episode of the week before we get into next week and start to recap these games. Everyone, enjoy the game and have fun.